What's up, I'm Carl, and I like to think of myself as a chef, even though I almost never cook. When I do cook, it's hardly anything more complicated than macaroni and cheese. I definitely don't work in a restaurant. I'm a blended learning designer, and that means I design using a combination of face-to-face, online, and even those on-the-job references. Things that you can look up when you're at work so that you don't have to leave the classroom. You don't have to leave your job at work to go to training. You can look it up and actually get stuff done. So I consider myself a chef because I feed the brains of the organizations that hire me. What do I mean by that? Well, here's a look inside an actual brain. And within your brain, you have lots of different brain cells, and these brain cells will connect and form what you see here, which is a synapse or neuron. So basically, the information that we know and have expertise in is physically connected between two brain cells. And to help me explain a little bit more of that, I have a special guest. Do you know who this is? I bet you do. Did you know that Jennifer Aniston is not only the star of Friends, but she was the star of the Jennifer Aniston neuron? If you've read the wonderful book Brain Rules by Dr. John Medina, you'll know that there was an actual research assignment where we had different participants would sit in an fMRI scan where we would actually measure the brain activity, and they were showing different pictures. So they would show pictures of lots of different people, and they noticed that they found one synapse in the brain that would light up every time it was showed a picture of Jen. So it would light up for, you know, like when she had her little short haircut for season one. It would light up later down the road when, you know, she was with Brad Pitt. Basically, any time that somebody was shown a picture of Jennifer Aniston, this one tiny neuron would light up. Now, we have billions of neurons in our head, so finding one is kind of like a needle in a haystack. So the Jennifer Aniston neuron was a very big discovery. We realized that this neuron wouldn't light up for, say, Christina Applegate or Kristen Wiig, or it wouldn't even light up for someone who had never heard of Jennifer Aniston. So what this was proof that our brains had physically changed as a result of learning about Jennifer Aniston. So, how much do you know about Jen? Are you the person, when you saw the picture, they were like, oh, it's that girl from that one show? Or were you the person that was like me, that was like, oh, that's Jennifer Aniston from Friends? Or were you an expert that said, oh, okay, I can tell by the hair that that's when she broke up with Brad Pitt but hadn't started dating Vince Vaughn yet? Maybe you read Us Weekly every week. There's always a story about her in there. The Jennifer Aniston, you become an expert the more you engage that synapse. The more you learn about it, the more you're going to know about Jen. And my line of work is to help people know more. So what does that mean? What does that mean based on the picture I just showed you of brain synapses coming together? What's the difference between these three different examples? Myelin. So this synapse is not only formed, but the more you use it, the more you engage that synapse, the brain cells get covered in a fatty white substance called myelin. The more that you fire that synapse, the more myelin you have, the more expertise that you have. Therefore, the more you're actually able to do things about Jennifer Aniston without thinking that hard about it. You've built up what researchers call automaticity, that you simply know stuff about Jennifer Aniston without a lot of effort. So my role as a chef who feeds the brains of the organizations that I work with is to help engage your neurons, to fire those synapses. So I've made a lot of online modules, and I actually feel like I should apologize for those. A lot of those modules are terrible. You don't learn anything from them. They take a lot of time, and they actually take a lot of money to produce and distribute and track and score and do all those things. The worst are the ones where they're just reading to you when the words are right on screen. But even worse than that is when they won't let you click next until the person is reading their narration, finished reading their narration. So what do you do as the reader? You've already skimmed through all the content. Are you engaged in the material? No, those synapses aren't firing at all. Instead, you're simply watching. That scrub bar go all the way across the bottom of the module until the next button lights up and you can get back to your work. I consider myself a chef because making that kind of module is a lot like making vegetables for a child who's not going to eat them. My wife and I have four boys. The oldest is 6 years old. Dinner at our house is challenging. That's one word for it. But I've learned as a parent that there is kind of a sweet spot between what is yummy enough that they'll eat it without me begging and crying, yet nutritious enough that I want them to. As a parent, as an occasional chef, I'm looking for that sweet spot between yummy and nutritious. And I really think, as a credentialed teacher, as a learning designer, that we're looking for the same thing. We're looking for content that is interesting enough that they'll engage with it, yet informative enough that we're seeing results and that it's helping us reach the strategies of what we're trying to teach. So for both, we are looking for those sweet spots. I consider myself a chef, and I use blended learning recipes to help feed the brains of the organizations that hire me.